Our next speaker is Rafael Gomez-Bombarelli. He's the Jeffrey Cheetah Associate Professor of Material Science and Engineering. And Rafael fuses physics-based atomistic simulation with machine learning to accelerate the discovery cycle of novel materials that can be used both for energy, sustainability, and healthcare. So he started bridging the health of the planet to health of humans, mm-hmm. which is part of the discussion that we hope to engage for the rest of the afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks very much for having me. And we're hearing about sort of sustainability and decarbonization. And some of it goes through purely digital solutions, right? You know, grid planning, load balancing, arbitrage. But a lot of it needs to go through actual physical chemicals and materials that get made. From agrochemicals to energy generation, energy conversion, energy storage. We're making 100 million tons of plastic every year, right? We probably need to do something about that. Or remediation of things that have, of damages we've done in the past. So at the same time as we have sort of these big needs, there is a class of tools that have exploded, right? And this is why we're all here and why these examples get stale by the week. And most of them are on data modalities that are text and images, but some of them are in the physical sciences too, right? So AlphaFold did solve a problem that was thought to be, you know, untractable. Humanities was one of the big scientific challenges. And it turned out it was solvable by a computer with 100,000 training data points. So it wasn't even a trillion tokens for AlphaFold. It was trained on 100,000 instances. And through a combination of all the things we've seen so far, right? More computers, faster algorithms, and just more data to throw at them. So the obvious question for us in material science, in computational material science, is how these two things come together, right? How can we deploy these technologies to invent new materials, and in particular in the urgent context of decarbonization and circularity? And you know, there's a list of things that could emerge, right? We could get materials that make better batteries, right? We could figure out how to do carbon capture efficiently, maybe out of direct air capture, how to valorize that CO2, right? Maybe there is some catalyst out there that can efficiently and cheaply convert this CO2 into something useful, like aviation fuel. So this is all these sort of, not holy grails, but sort of really useful applications that would go through discovering a material that does that. And then what can AI do in order to fix this? And the first thing we need to challenge is that we're actually asking for a more difficult problem than most machine learning applications, because we're asking machine learning to do better than the best scientist has ever done, which is harder than the typical generative AI applications. We're mostly asking to match some person just at super speed and no cost, right? So ChatGPT doesn't write particularly well, but it writes particularly fast, right? So, and then we have a lot less data. Much of it lives inside the paywalls and companies and secret sources. So we're never gonna be able to compete with a trillion tokens or all the text in the internet, all the images in the internet. And coming from simulations, we postulate that there may be some inductive bias, there might be some extra information in physics that makes our machine learning more agile. I would say that has not been the case for text. Large language models use none of the grammar and syntax that has taken sort of 2,000 years to develop as a science, right? So this is a hypothesis. So what can AI do for us right now? So it can totally predict the property of a material, right? We've created custom neural networks that can look at matter, but maybe where atoms sit somewhere in a crystal, or how atoms are connected in a molecule, or maybe the grain boundaries in an alloy, or maybe the dispersion of particles in a composite, and predict the properties of some material. So there is plenty of custom-made neural network architectures that do this, given that if there is enough training data. Enough can be maybe hundreds, maybe millions when things work really, really well, particularly training on computer-generated data. So we can go and predict how toxic, what color a molecule would be, and you know, how tough an alloy would be, that those tools exist today. There are also tools for AI to tell us what's a good material that does something. So this is a very generative task, and this is something that collectively has been around for getting close to a decade now, since 2015, 2016. So this is the opposite that I said before. Before I said, we got models that go from matter to property. Well, these are the opposite. These are models that go from the property I want to the matter that satisfies it. So these are purely generative. They've been proposed for molecules. You will hear maybe about from Connor Coley when he talks about health. He will describe what these have done for health. There was one paper, 2023, just weeks ago, from Google DeepMind doing this for crystals. So AI can create materials or can suggest materials that would fulfill some property. And it can also predict what the material would do. AI can also tell us how to make something, both for inorganic materials like ceramics or a catalyst, or for organic molecules. Those are drugs, I apologize, but this also works for materials such as the organic light emitting diodes in your phones. So you can ask a machine learning model, well, I found this fantastic molecule that was suggested by an AI, and the AI told me it's really, really good. How do I make it? And it's possible to construct. The AI can predict the list of precursors you should buy and the way you could combine them to go and get this molecule or this material made. And just these last few months, since ChatGPT came out and the large language models, AI can go read scientific literature. There was work done in that space for almost a decade too, and now with large language models, it's really being commoditized. So these are two very recent examples. Left-hand side is for a class of material called MOFs, which are they can be used for carbon capture. They can be used for dehumidifying air to get air water out of the air to make air conditioning more effective. An agent, a ChatGPT-like software, can go read a scientific paper and extract tabulated data to maybe do something downstream with it, or to maybe learn new chemical synthesis, or all these synthesis from this paper, I can predict new synthesis out of the literature. In this preprint from on the right, from CMU, same idea, the chatbot can ask Google, so it can go Google stuff, it can go read the manual for some piece of equipment and propose what to make, how to make it, or extract information from the literature, from papers. All those things exist. But there is a number of things AI cannot really do for us in materials, right? And one of them, and this goes right to the previous speaker, is decide what's important, right? What's important is a human decision. AI can trace, maybe, the boundary between trade-offs. Like, well, if you want more of these, you need to give up some of that. So that's something that AI can trace for us. But the onus of what actually is important that needs to be decided by a person, right? We really haven't gotten to that point yet. Surprisingly or not surprisingly, AI cannot convince people to do experiments, right? So you can have all these AIs saying, well, this material is fantastic, right? You should invest 4 years of your life trying to make it. And that hasn't quite worked yet, right? So there is this, and this applies to many other technologies or other areas of application of AI, where people like to own what they do and they like to understand why they do things. And scientists are not laborers. They're people that are there to do things that are creative and fulfilling. So it turns out, and then they also know what they're doing, which we'll go back to that next point in a minute. So typically, there is no natural conduit for this ability of machine learning models to suggest stuff. And traditional scientific practices to just absorb them and fulfill them. And then following up on that, right, like AI cannot actually make anything, right? Like this is, when you ask ChatGPT to do something, give me this beautiful poem, it makes me so happy. Like the whole process happens inside the computer, right? It's purely digital from the beginning to the end. But if we're talking about decarbonization and figuring out how to make more sustainable cement, somebody needs to go make cement, right? So we need to test that this thing is, that this whole idea works in the lab, and then see if we can actually scale it up to megatons. And AI has sort of very little control over that, right? Just testing it in the lab is sort of one step further. And then this it was called alignment a minute ago. It's like, it's the same theme. Like, we really have no guardrails. When things fail catastrophically, machine learning models can give sort of really bad property predictions outside the space where they were trained on. They can generate nonsensical materials to go make if you ask them for, like, things that are not feasible. Or, you know, if you trained on alloys, that machine learning model is going to produce ridiculous ceramics, right? These are very different classes of materials that don't really talk to one another too much. And then they can hallucinate and make propose things that are not real. So this is sort of where the field is, and I'll sign this recent paper that here just one building down from here from Klaus Jensen's lab, but also other examples. There was another one in Nature today, out of Berkeley on the West Coast, trying to close this gap, right? So okay, we've got AI that can predict properties, it can predict what to do, it can predict synthesis paths. Well, now the rubber meets the road. It needs to interact with the real world, and that's through robots. That's through a very physical, mechanical or chemo-mechanical object that needs to be constructed and maintained and operated. But in order to embody this creativity from AI, it needs to be hooked to a medium that can make and test. So that's exactly where the field is right now, right? This couple of sort of high-profile efforts trying to do all these things, right? Hook up all these digital pieces, but then making up the physical realization that can produce data, learn on it, and iterate, sort of working alongside the domain expert or creative scientific enterprise driven by humans. And our last bullet that's gonna, once this works, we will realize that we need to figure out that we need to invent supply chain compatible, economically feasible, sort of drop-in materials, and somehow hook all of that into the former pieces that I just described. And this is my last slide, thanks very much. Yeah, thank you.
We have time for a couple of questions.
Yeah, I mean, energy storage, right, like batteries, there's this huge appetite. New battery chemistry is coming up all the time. We work on electrolytes right now. So electrolytes, electrolytes are the reason why they still ask you about Samsung phones before you get on a plane, or why you cannot put your laptop in your suitcase, right? Battery electrolytes are liquids. They can catch fire. So there's this big, big push to trade them with some solid that has the same properties, but just won't squirt out and catch fire if the battery is punctured. So for instance, that would be a place where there is a lot going on. And it's a place where AI makes sense. It's like, well, there's all these chemistries we could use and all these constraints of how they need to perform. So what are creative options to cycle fast? Thanks.
Paul? You mentioned about the workflow for good papers. I was wondering if there's an example of that in materials, or could you give us an example of what the goal of that was? Has it actually worked?
Yeah, so I think sort of there is a bucket of examples that have to do with just getting something made. So they go, the agent reads synthesis papers and extracts synthesis recipes. And like I said, there was a paper in Nature today about this, where essentially the task is, let's just make something that no one had made before. Doesn't really do anything, right? It's only about the synthesis part of the world. So it's not particularly good for anything, but the agent reads the papers, extracts the recipes, and tabulates the recipes, and then compares this new chemistry that maybe a generative model predicted or maybe somebody drew, right? That part could be generative, but it wasn't in this example. And then compares that material with everything in the big list of recipes it extracted and says, well, you kind of look like that. So we're going to start making a synthesis like that synthesis. Gets the precursors, mixes them, bakes them, measures what came out, and it's like, well, we're going to need more of X, more of Y. And I think the beauty of this is that the tools for active learning are there as well. So actually, the characterization data feeds back into making new decisions and fine-tuning the synthesis conditions. But those don't make anything. In this example from Jensen lab, we made molecules that have certain color and optical properties. So it's like, let's make it more red. Typically, red is harder to make. So let's make molecules as red as we can and see if the robot can explore, sort of extrapolate further in chemical space.
Thank you.
Nice.